Okay, welcome everyone. I am excited to talk to you today about a project I've been working on along with Matt's help. I have been working on this e-commerce store for digital downloads. And so this is a talk that's going to talk about the architecture, but Matt and I are actually going to do some live streams with Stripe in order to show like the whole process in depth. But I wanted to give you a flavor and show how one example of using Eleventy that's not just like a blog, which great, we love all the blogs, but it's nice to see like other use cases. So if you also have a talk idea for other use cases for Eleventy, please let us know. All right. Like you said, my name is Sia Karamalegos. I'm on Twitter. I'm pretty active there. If you want to contact me, I'm the Green Greek, and Sia.codes is my Eleventy blog. And I try to publish a lot of content about Eleventy and other things that are like serverless and whatnot, and performance, web performance. I do a lot of that as well. This is me at Mardi Gras. I like making my own costumes. All right. So what are we actually going to build? Let me get out of this so I can show you. Wait, do I have my server running? Let me start my server because I don't want to buy something live. My co-hosts keep an eye on the little list of people waiting. All right, we are live, and I should do this actually in my other browser so my automatic info doesn't pop up. Let's do the DevTools one. Like, pro tip when you're speaking and showing something live, do a browser that doesn't have all your addresses and stuff saved in it. anyways, this is my artsy craftsy website. It's not fully built out, and it does have some really old blog posts, but I have some Etsy shops that sell crochet patterns, and then I have another one that sells these coloring pages I made quite a while ago and some artwork, some digital download artwork. But I always wanted to host it on my own site, right? Because you know, indie web and whatnot. And I want to own my own content. And also, I'll still have them on Etsy, but it's nice to have stuff hosted on your own site as well. So now I have a shop. This is in development and I'm still making it prettier, but you can see I have two products and we'll talk about where these come from, but I can buy this and then it goes to a Stripe checkout page. And I mean, these are really email addresses, but oh, well. We got to do the good old 4242 Stripe thing, name on card. Let's give it Priscilla since she's video bombing my talk. Pay. No, well, you're not. Actually, I should save that card because I use it so much over here.
Yeah, Chrome will allow you to do that. That's useful.
All right. So you see, we get a thank you page. This thank you page is actually the live page, and we'll talk about why that is. And so what happens next is, what email did I give it? I don't even know. Do you remember what email I told it to do?
I think it was Cleo and Calliope, I want to say.
Okay, it's fine. I can show another email. So then afterwards, I'll get an email. And it will give, this needs to be, if anyone's good at email styles, please tell me because I am failing immensely. But you'll get an email, you'll get an email receipt from Stripe, but then you'll get an email with an expiring link for this digital download file, which is just a PDF. So this, I think it, in dev mode, it expires in 1 minute, but that's how it all works together. So let's see what that looks like in terms of the architecture. Slideshow. So who are the major players? So we have to think about all the entities. So I'm not doing one server backend, which is how you would do it in the old days. I'm piecing together different things. And part of my motivation was, how free can I make this? And so it's like mostly free unless I hit it big time or something, which is doesn't really get that much traffic at the moment. But so of course we're using Eleventy. That's my static site generator. And that's also how I'm creating my products and things like that. GitHub, of course, that's my origin repo. And then Netlify is where I'm hosting. They do static site hosting and serverless functions. So I'm using both of those here. And of course they do a lot more. There's Stripe. And in this case, I'm using products, checkout, and email payment receipts. and webhooks. I didn't list it there, but we're going to see. I'm going to show you a lot of diagrams in a minute. And then AWS. So these files are saved in AWS S3, and I don't want people to have a permalink. It's actually a private S3 bucket. There's this thing you can do called signed URLs to create a temporary URL that expires after a certain amount of time. And then I'm using SendGrid for email at the moment, at least. So those are the major players. Now let's see how it all works together. I'm going to go through three different processes. So one, we just want to build and deploy the website. So what does that look like? Well, we have my laptop here, and when I do a Git push, that goes up to GitHub. And then when you create a Netlify site and you link it to GitHub, it will automatically create this webhook. So whenever you push to main, or if you have a PR, it will trigger a build and deploy, which is really handy. And then that build and deploy, it's doing my production build of my website. And so that's when I need to grab those products, right, for that product list. And that product list comes from the Stripe API. I've gone into the Stripe dashboard and created products, but I need to get their prices and the list of them so that I can actually render them. And I can show some of that code. Actually, yeah, let's just do that now while we're... Can I drag this over? Is it going to go on top? Nope. I told you I'm not used to doing real slides anymore. I should make this bigger because that's my big screen. This is not... Oh yeah, this is the file I wanted. All right, y'all can see that okay? So what's going on here is in my underscore data folder, I have global data, like a lot of you have metadata file or navigation JSON, but I've also created a global data file for prices. And this is because each of my products just has one price, but in reality, in Stripe, you can actually have a product with multiple prices. So I've simplified my requests because they are two different things. You would have to request both. So what I'm doing here is I'm getting the prices, and then I'm also grabbing the products for each price. And then now I have this global data called prices that works. And this is an async. Yeah, this is an async request, which works. I think you have to set something up in the config though. Yeah. Let's see what I did here. Anyone else know this? I forgot to like look this up. Nope, it just works. That's kind of cool. Oh, it's how you export it. Yeah, I was like, I know there's some trick to doing async data, global data. And the way you do it is by exporting the async function. And then when you do a build, which... So when I run my server, that's some stuff I'm console logging, but it will go fetch those products asynchronously and then build all the pages, which is really cool. I figured y'all know how, for the most part, like now it's just available in my project as the global data prices. So if I go to the shop page, I'm going to do include product list. So now I need to go into that product list partial or template. And now we can see if prices. So prices is just available. That data from Stripe is just available globally. And if y'all have more questions about that global data set, please let me know. And Discord is probably the easiest place. But I wanted this talk to be mostly about how it all fits together. But if you aren't sure about that stuff, like totally let me know and, you know, can help with that as well. So that's getting the products. And this is, of course, the production build cycle. But there's this other cool thing that you can do is you can store your environment variables inside of Netlify. And instead of running Eleventy directly on the command line, I run the Netlify CLI, and it's this Netlify dev command. And that is why you saw up here, it injects all of my build settings, so all my API keys basically, which is really cool. So I can set those in the UI for Netlify, which is kind of critical because there's a lot of them going on here. So this is the build process. It looks a bit complicated, but if you've ever used Netlify, these are all pretty standard. And then all we did was we added an async global data. And then I'm also using the environment variable feature of Netlify. So that's build and deploy. And then the checkout process, this is where I'm going to get Matt to talk a little bit too, but this part's really fun. So I'm just handing it off to Stripe so that I don't have to worry about making it look, wait, is my server still running? You know, like it looks legit, and there's ways, we haven't done this yet, but we were going to brand this a bit more. And also I don't want to deal with, you know, managing other people's credit cards and payments is kind of scary to me. And I'd rather just do that through a vendor like Stripe. So what happens? We have someone coming to my website and they want to click the buy button. And then we have Netlify and Stripe. And so on click, it hits my API checkout route, which is a Netlify function. And in the live stream, we'll talk more in detail about that. And it runs this create checkout function. And then what that does, it says, you know, we want these light items, and it sends us to Stripe. And now we are inside of this Stripe checkout, which you can see is actually on their domain as well. But if I clicked out of it, this little arrow, it just goes back to the page I was on. Oh, you can set where that goes. But yeah, so that's triggering the Stripe checkout. And then after that checkout completes on that page, it returns back to that thanks page. Remember that we saw when I did that purchase. Now, Matt, I don't know what all you want to highlight about the checkout process.
Yeah, thanks for having me. First of all, my name is Matt Ling. You can find me at mattling_ on Twitter. Yeah, I'm a developer advocate at Stripe. So I know a little bit about checkout. If you haven't said, yeah, I mean, there's a lot to talk about with checkout. So I'll try and just touch on some of the random things that come to mind that are really useful about it. It's a fully hosted checkout page at Stripe. So you really can like let Stripe do a lot of the heavy lifting around collecting payments. Checkout itself, though, can do a lot of the other things that maybe are worth thinking about. You can also do things like setting up cards for future payments. So you might not be taking a payment right now, but you might want to charge a user when they're off session, meaning not on your site, you know, in the future. So checkout will do that. A good example is during pandemic times, if a restaurant wanted to guarantee a booking, you know, they could set up your card, and then, you know, they could maybe even put a, like they might authorize a certain amount of it. Anyway, and then subscriptions, obviously, right? So really, really important use case. So if Sia wanted to actually create a subscription service for these prints, you know, so that I get one every month automatically, right? And I don't have to go and fill out my card details or whatever payment method I decide to use. Another important thing about checkout. And then, you know, you can kick off subscriptions with it as well. Yeah, like it offers tons of functionality, like subscription upsells. So like, let's say I'm paying monthly, but actually I'd rather just pay for a whole year, and then Sia gives me a break on the price. You can configure that all through the dashboard. You can do things like abandoned cart. So like if I like right at the last minute kind of go, ooh, I'm not sure if I'm going to buy this. And then after a certain amount of time, Sia can like reach back out to me and say, oh, hey, you know, didn't you want to have this beautiful thing? And you know, actually get me to check out, which is really useful. Stripe Tax is now available through checkout. So you can do things like, you know, if you have a tax obligation in Ireland, Sia could automatically, without any kind of, with one line of code, automatically calculate and collect the amount of tax that happens to be owed on a product such as that. And we have like a huge list of products and tax codes for different business cases. What else can we talk about? Yeah, payment methods, right? So check out of the box gives you Google Pay, Apple Pay. You know, if you're selling in Asia, there's like WeChat Pay, I think, and then a bunch of others, FPX for Malaysia. So like you get all of those payment methods like right out of the box, which is really important because like I lived in Berlin for like 17 years, and like, the two largest payment methods, believe it or not, were like, well, cash and debit card, right? So like credit cards were not really the most popular payment method in Berlin. So it's really important to be able to like offer your customers the kind of payment methods that they feel like really comfortable with and they trust, and checkout automatically surfaces those for you. So you don't have to like lift, it's not a lift at all, basically. Yeah, I think I'll stop there with checkout features. Like I could go on, but I don't want to like hijack.
Yeah, like we could collect addresses if we were actually shipping. There's all sorts of things.
Yeah, totally. But yeah, shipping address collection, tax rates, and all that.
Yeah, yeah. So there's this other cool thing. So right, so this is just checkout, and we could do something on redirect to, you know, send the file and stuff. But as Matt was actually telling me before, because I didn't even realize this, because I just use credit cards and I'm American, you know. But for example, if someone uses a debit card or they don't finish checkout, that payment hasn't been completed. So we can't rely on that redirect, because also something might happen to the internet connection. So instead, we're going to use this cool feature called webhooks inside of Stripe. So on payment success, we now deal with these four things. And this is completely independent from the customer navigation and everything. This is just something that happens. When that checkout complete event occurs inside of Stripe, you register a webhook inside of Stripe, and then it will go ahead and use that webhook, which actually points to my serverless function inside of Netlify. That's a purchase success function, which is cool. And then, so we get that event, and then we actually, there's a little bit more to this. We request the line items from it so that we know what they purchased, and we get the customer email. And then the first thing we do is I send a little request to S3 and I say, get a signed URL for this particular product that they bought. Basically, it's a PDF file from my private S3 bucket. And then it sends back that URL. And then I, of course, need to send that email to the customer who bought it. So I email the URL from SendGrid. I'm still working out like the best email method, but that's what I have for now, because I know they have a pretty good free tier. Literally all of this has pretty good free tiers. Of course, Stripe, you just have to pay a percent and, you know, whatever. That's with any payment vendor. S3 is only a 1-year free deal, but I feel like the S3 buckets, like currently my monthly bill is around like 45 cents a month. So it'll probably go up a few cents. I don't know. But almost all of this is totally free. So I'm not having to pay like, you know, some $20 fee per month to sell my products online, which was my goal here. Because I know there's probably a lot of other independent crafty people who maybe want to sell things, but you know, it just doesn't make sense in some of the, you know, when you're kind of earlier stage and you don't actually have that $20 per month in sales, then, you know, it'd be nice to have some of these different things. But, oh yeah. Do you want to talk more about the webhooks? Sorry, Matt.
Yeah, sure. I mean, yeah, it's a pretty important part of like of your application, because ultimately like it enables a lot of different things. But firstly, mainly it lets you get notified about really important things happening on your account, payments probably being the most important thing, that you're getting paid. And then you can go do things like fulfill your orders and what have you. But also because I guess because of the asynchronous nature, like of a lot of payment methods these days, like, so for example, like a SEPA debit, which is very, very popular in Europe, you know, will take like 2 business days to clear. So you're not going to know about that payment success immediately. You really need to have this webhook endpoint that's sitting there listening for those important events so that you know you got paid and you can actually supply your product or service to your customer. So yeah, there are 2 pretty important things that the webhook endpoint will give you. And our client libraries, they pretty much give you all the things that you need to build an effective webhook endpoint. I won't go too deeply into that because I think in the live streams, we're probably going to really, really go in deep on that one.
Yeah, definitely. I will. In case y'all haven't seen Netlify functions, the way they work is I have a functions folder. I mean, you can actually put this in a Netlify/functions folder, and then they are JavaScript functions. So they're run in Node and they're run independently of build, and they work like a URL or like an API route. I actually have a redirect set up for them too. So if someone went to API/whatever, it would hit those functions. So if you're really curious about all that, you should come check out the live streams. I'm sure they're going to be recorded and posted somewhere too, right,
Matt? They will, yeah. We'll stream them live and they'll be automatically recorded. The first one is next Friday, the 18th. There's going to be 3. I think we're going to do it in 3 phases, right, Sia? Like product management, checkout session management, and then the webhook endpoint in the 3rd one. So it's going to be the 18th. Mm-hmm. I believe the 24th, and then the Friday following that, which I can't remember. My math is terrible. So,
and we'll post that, or both of us will tweet it clearly.
Yeah.
I'll also post it in the Eleventy Discord in case you're curious. And yeah, I don't know. Are there any other questions or anything or any other points we need to bring up?
I'm good.
Awesome. Well, I hope that was interesting for y'all. If you're interested in, you know, I like showing the capability of doing things like this easy and free way, because I feel like a lot of people just, you know, want to do quick startups, and maybe they're not like a big company, but they're trying out different concepts, and it's just a really nice thing to do. So I'm happy we're doing this little project.
Yeah, all I'm right. Learning loads about Eleventy. It's really awesome.
Yeah, and Netlify.
Yeah, that too.
And of course, you can use this kind of framework to work with like almost anything, especially like, you know, the Stripe, Netlify, Eleventy thing, and then like whatever your services are pinged to different API things, which works well.